So our first speaker, I'm going to introduce all the speakers and the panelists. So our first speaker will be Anne Thornton. Ms. Thornton is the Vice Provost at University Librarian for the Columbia University in New York City, and where she is responsible for one of the top five academic research library systems in the North America, with world-class physical digital collections. Here, the physical collections, one of them here. And expert staff in support of the research, teaching, and the learning at Columbia. And she came to the Columbia in June 2015 after serving for the nearly two decades at the New York Public Library, where she was most recently the Andrew Mellon Director, a position she held since 2012, with responsibility for the research, reference services, collection development, preservation, fellowship, and exhibitions. Anne.
So on behalf of Columbia University Libraries, I would like to extend a very warm welcome to each and every one of you. Thank you for attending today's event, Kuo Ping Wen, Scholar, Reformer, Statesman. This very special book signing is an important occasion for Columbia University. I want to express my deepest gratitude to our sponsors, to the Weatherhead East Asian Institute, the Department of East Asian Languages and Cultures, Columbia Confucius Institute, the Center for Chinese Education, Teachers College, and the Office of Global Centers. Also, my thanks to all of our guest speakers, specifically Carolyn Sue Balser as the family member of Dr. Kuo Ping Wen, for her leadership in organizing the Kuo Ping Wen book project, and for working with Jim Chang and the brilliant staff of the Starr East Asian Library to make this event possible. Dr. Wen, the first Chinese student who received his PhD from Columbia's Teachers College in 1914, had an extremely distinguished career in both China and the United States, which has been revealed through this book project, the subject of this evening's event. When celebrating his accomplishments today, we not only hope to inform memory about this prominent alumnus, but also to re-emphasize Columbia's mission to prepare the global leaders in all possible areas, and Columbia University Libraries' commitment to support this mission. Columbia's libraries and its collections are a foundation for supporting research and teaching and are central to the university's intellectual distinction and its highest global ambitions. By working together with our partners both here at Columbia and globally, we create the greatest opportunities for scholars and students to encounter global thought. Thanks again to everyone who makes this event tonight possible. Thank you.
And our next speaker will be Professor Eugenia Lin. Professor Eugenia Lin is the director of the Weatherhead East Asian Institute. And she's also a professor at EALAC. She received her BA from Stanford University, MA BA from Stanford University, and a PhD from UCLA. And she is interested in the broad range of topics in late imperial and the modern Chinese history, with a particular focus on the history of science and the industry, mass media, consumer culture, emotion and gender, as well as law and the urban society. She is also interested in issues of historiography and the critical theory and in the study of East Asia. Professor Lin.
I wanted to also welcome everybody. I'm the director of the Weatherhead East Asian Institute. So in that capacity, I want to first say that the Weatherhead, as an institute that really wants to encourage the study of East Asia around campus, is really quite happy to collaborate with the library and support really exciting events, such as the book panel, the book signing, and the panel that we have before us today. I also wanted to thank Jim, Chen, who has been doing very exciting events here at CV Star. I used the word last time, entrepreneurial. He's very innovative and entrepreneurial in his efforts to make a library not just kind of a repository of old archives, of dusty books, but indeed a really live, vital intellectual space. And again, today's event, I think, which speaks to a lot of people, both academics and beyond, is a perfect example of Jim's entrepreneurial efforts and the potential for collaboration that the Institute looks forward to in the future with the library. The other thing I would like to say is that I'm very excited about this event personally, well, academically and personally. I am a scholar of the Republican period, and this is a really kind of transitional period in Chinese history, moving from the period when it was once a leading empire in the early modern world to collapse in 1911 and to reemerge as a nation state, not necessarily that steadily at first. There was a lot of anxiety, a period of warlordism, a period when China was encountering imperialist powers, and when it was quite weak. But in a period of weakness, there is a possibility for opportunity and the emergence for very fascinating and heroic individuals. I myself like to study these individuals, and I think Kuo Ping Wen is a perfect example of somebody who kind of took advantage of the shakiness of the era to really kind of rethink China's place in the world. And what's so exciting for us is that he did so coming to Columbia. So as a person who attended Teachers College in the early 20th century, he is one a pioneering figure in many ways with that those early generations of Chinese intellectuals who were able to come abroad and take advantage of the new resources that they could then bring back to China and really help build China into what it is today in many ways. So I think this is a perfect place for us to celebrate a man who is so fascinating, and I look forward to the ensuing program. Thank you.
Thanks, Professor Ling. And our next speaker will speak on behalf of the EALAC, Department of East Asian Language and Cultures, Professor Wei Shang. Professor Wei Shang received his BA and MA from Beijing University and his PhD from Harvard. Professor Shang specialized in pre-modern Chinese literature and culture, especially fiction and the drama of the Ming and the Qing dynasties. His research interests also include print culture, book history, the intellectual history of the same era. Professor Shang.
Well, first of all, I want to thank Dr. Chen for hosting today's event in celebrating the publication of the book, Kuo Ping Wen, Scholar, Reformer, Statesman. I also want to thank Mr. Ryan Allen and Dr. Liu Ji, right, for having put together this wonderful book to document Dr. Kuo Ping Wen's life and his achievements. The publication of this book provides us with a fitting occasion for commemorating Mr. Kuo Ping Wen and his remarkable contributions to Chinese higher education and the Sino-US cultural exchange, among other things. Mr. Kuo graduated from Columbia's Teachers College, where he received his MA degree in 1912 and his PhD degree 2 years later. His PhD dissertation is concerned with the Chinese system of a public education. It was published by the Teachers College immediately after his graduation in 1915. And the Chinese edition of the book came out in Shanghai in 1916. Mr. Kuo was one of the leaders of the movement of what was then called 教育救国, right, seeking to modernize or to rather to save China through education reform. And indeed, he was the pioneer of the group of TC students who returned to China after graduation. And altogether, they ushered in a new era in the history of modern Chinese education by founding nearly 2 dozen private universities. They're all TC students. Okay. Due to the time constraints, it will be impossible for me to go over the long list of his accomplishments in so many different areas. But it's noteworthy that he was one of the co-founders of the China Institute in New York City. And he also served as a director from 1926 to 1930. And he later served as the president of the Sino-American Cultural Society in Washington, D.C., which himself founded in 1958. As you may have heard, maybe Dr. Chen will tell you more about this, that is, Columbia's East Asian Star Library has recently acquired complete archives of the China Institute. So as we plow through this enormously rich documents about its long history, I'm sure we will learn more about Mr. Kuo Ping Wen's role he played in founding, in kind of guiding this institute that has since played such an important role in enhancing the mutual understanding between U.S. and China. And as we gather together here today, I want to take this opportunity, I'm speaking for, on behalf of the department, to pay tribute on behalf of the Department of East Asian Languages and Cultures, and we will do whatever we can to ensure that Mr. Kuo Ping Wen's achievements as part of the legacy of Columbia's Chinese students will continue to be honored and treasured for the generations to come. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Shang. Now, next speaker will be the Professor Lening Liu at the EALAC and also director of the Columbia China Institute of Chinese Language Pedagogy. Professor Liu was born and raised in Xi'an, China. In 1977, right after the Cultural Revolution, he entered the college as part of the extremely selected group of the students to finally end the years of the disruption of higher education in China. After receiving his BA in Chinese language and the literature from Shanxi Normal University in 1982, and an MA in history of Chinese language in 1985, he came to the United States in 1990 and studied linguistics at the University of Florida. He joined the Columbia faculty in 1995 and received his PhD in 1996. Professor Liu's research interests are in the areas of historical syntax, discourse, grammar, and the Chinese language pedagogy. He has published a number of the articles on the evolution of Chinese conjunctive adverbs and the rhetorical structures of Chinese and the history and the innovation of Chinese pedagogy. Professor Liu.
Thank you, Dr. Chen, and thank you for inviting me to this important occasion. It is my pleasure and honor to join the distinguished guests and our authors of the biography of Dr. Kuo Ping Wen. And Confucius Institute at Columbia is a research institute dedicated to Chinese culture and the Chinese language in particular. And we have been teamed up with Professor and Dr. Chen to organize some, you know, culture events. Last time was on Chinese calligraphy, and this time is on Dr. Kuo Ping Wen's biography. For me, I heard Dr. Kuo Ping Wen's name for the very first time last June at Shanghai University of Finance and Economics, where we co-organized the sixth International Conference on Business Chinese and Cross-Cultural Communication. And during the conference, the vice president of the Shanghai University of Finance and Economics told me, actually, the collaboration and the cooperation between Columbia and Shanghai Finance and Economics University, you know, goes back long time ago. And I was a little bit, you know, I was pleasantly surprised, and I asked, in what way? And she told me, actually, our university was founded by one of the Columbia graduates. And I had no idea who he was, and she told me that was Professor Dr. Kuo Ping Wen. And she told me, actually, you know, on their campus, there is a, you know, statue of, you know, Dr. Kuo Ping Wen. So I learned about, you know, Dr. Kuo Ping Wen and his story, you know, right there, you know, in Shanghai. And when I came back, and Jim told me there will be an event, you know, celebrating Dr. Kuo Ping Wen's life and his contribution to Chinese educational reform. And I was very pleased, and we are very happy to make a very humble contribution to co-sponsoring this event. And Shanghai University of Finance and Economics has become the most selective, one of the most selective universities in China. And its graduates enjoy the highest starting pay in China. And so that's something we can celebrate as well here. Okay, so without overdue, and I just want to thank Dr. Chen again, and Dr. Kuo Ping Wen's family members, and the authors and the panelists. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Liu. And then our next speaker will be the one of our sponsors again, Ms. Xin Peng. Ms. Xin Peng joined the Columbia University, Columbia Global Center in 2009. She now serves as the executive director and the CFO for the network of global centers. Before that, she worked as the portfolio manager and the VP senior research analyst at various investment firms before she joined the Columbia. Ms. Xin Peng.
Good afternoon. I'm Xin Peng, executive director and the CFO of for Columbia Global Centers. We are honored to co-sponsor this exciting event on Kuo Ping Wen, scholar, reformer, statesman. The Columbia Global Centers are a network of 8 centers that promote and facilitate the collaborative and impactful engagement for our faculty, students, and alumni with the world to enhance understanding, address global challenges, and advance knowledge and its exchange. Over the past year, our Global Center in Beijing has pursued an inspiring project to showcase the rich history between China and Colombia. The first stage of this project is a short documentary that highlights the contribution of Columbia Chinese alumni, including Kuo Ping Wen, to the fields of science, education, economics, and politics in China. We are excited to build on this project and further explore these rich connections through many more projects and events just like this one today. I would like to thank the Starr Library for organizing today's event, and I hope you all enjoy the talk.
Thanks. Our last, but certainly most important, you know, speaker behind the scene, everything, Carolyn Xu Braser. Carolyn is a designer, philanthropist, art collector, based in Los Angeles and in New York. A graduate of the Wheaton College. And Carolyn is founder and the president of Snoopy Incorporation, the infant wear company based in New York City. And as a philanthropist, she has done many, many important projects, including Xu Bing's work and Xu Bing's current work staying on our wall. And she did Xu Bing's work for the tobacco in Virginia, including both exhibition and the documentaries. And also Carolyn has sponsored and contributed many schools and courses in China, Taiwan, and she is an important sponsor and donors of the libraries. Ms. Carolyn Xu Brayson.
Welcome and thank you all for coming here. And again, I'd like to extend a special thanks to Professor Jim Tsung and the CV Starr East Asian Library for hosting and coordinating this event. I want to take the opportunity to say a few words about my great-granduncle, Kuo Ping Wen, words that I hope you'll remember when you read this wonderful book. Kuo Ping Wen's one consistent belief throughout his life was that understanding and developing cross-cultural relations with other countries was the key to building a strong Chinese nation, a nation that would stand shoulder to shoulder with other world powers. Today, Kuo Ping Wen is recognized as one of the great educators of 20th century China. He emphasized a modern liberal arts curriculum of math, science, foreign languages, combined with the study of our classical Chinese. It was his firm belief that education should not neglect the building of one's character. In his view, ethical education was the integration of traditional and modern teaching methods that upheld the concept of the ideal man, a concept that prizes loyalty, faith, steadfastness, and respectability. Kuo Ping Wen believed that this timeless principle is the basis for success, whether from an individual, a people, or a nation. Now please join me in welcoming the contributors of the book as they share their work with you and what Kuo Ping Wen means to them. Thank you.
Yeah, I have known Carolyn and her husband, Renee Brayson, for quite a long time, since I first arrived in New York City. And I know both of them are working on the very important documentary films about Jewish peoples, Jews in Shanghai during World War II. So we're looking forward to seeing these important documentary films. And also, I'd like to start to turn over to the attention to our important authors for tonight, this afternoon events. First, I want to introduce our discussant, Professor David Gedalecia. And David is the Michael Fisher Professor of History at the College of Worcester in Ohio. His area of interest are Neo-Confucian interpretation of the Chinese classics, Confucian scholarship during the Yuan Dynasty, and early Sino-American relations. And the next one is Dr. Rain Allen. Dr. Rain Allen is the doctoral fellow and the PhD student in the Department of International and Transcultural Studies at the Teachers College, Columbia University, majoring in the international education and the political science. He is currently working on his dissertation on the rise of the global university rankings and the high education development in China. Our next author is Dr. Ji Liu. He's again a doctoral fellow and a PhD student in comparative international education and economics at the Teachers College, Columbia University. His research focused on the economics of education with a special interest on how policy institutions and the context influence teachers and the students. The last author is Dr. Yanqiu Zheng. He's a PhD candidate in East Asian history of the Northwestern University and specialized in modern Chinese history. He's currently completing his dissertation titled Reorienting Orientalism, The Making of Chinese Cultural Diplomacy in United States, 1926 to 1974. So without further ado, I'm going to turn to the discussant, Professor Gedalecia.
Thank you all for coming. I'm surrounded here by quite a group of scholars of this period and of Kuo Ping Wen's life and achievements. Excuse me. I know we're on time constraints here because I'm sure you want to all get back home and watch the vice presidential debate tonight, so I'll try to be brief. I don't think I can assume that everybody knows all the details about Kuo Ping Wen, and if I told you most of what I know, probably I wouldn't give these esteemed scholars a chance to speak. So I'm going to introduce him to you, since the theme is scholar, reformer, and statesman. He was born in Shanghai. He attended some very seminal institutes and schools with Christian missionary connections. These connections, such as with the Lowry Institute in Shanghai, the Qingxin Tang, for example, is one of these things, the Pure Light Academy, brought him to the United States to a college in the Midwest with which I'm somewhat familiar, and some of you might be. I know there's a friend here named Vivian who is intimately connected with the college. This is Wooster College in Ohio, not the one in Massachusetts. Actually, there isn't a Wooster College in Massachusetts, but the names seem to run together. I'm going to say a few words about Kuo Ping Wen at Wooster, since it's the earliest of the topics that we'll consider. But I'm sure you know that after Wooster, he went to Columbia, got his master's and PhD, and as you've heard, wrote an important book on the structure, history of Chinese education, going way back in time to the early dynasties, and went back to China and founded some very important universities, such as Southeastern University in Nanjing, and you heard about Shanghai University of Finance and Economics. And after those achievements, he was also involved in many international activities. Possibly the best known would be his work at the end of the war, the founding of the United Nations. But of course, I think what concerns many of us here is the work he did in China Institute, which in terms of cross-cultural understanding and education has really made important contributions to understanding toward international understanding. But I want to say a few things about his career at Wooster and let the gentleman to my right talk about the more detailed aspects of his life, probably the more important aspects of his life. I want to quote a person with whom I'm sure you're familiar, Robert Maynard Hutchins, who was the president of the University of Chicago. He said famously that the best education for the best is the best education for all. And it seemed to me that what he was saying is something that rings true and has some resonance in terms of Kuo Ping Wen's life. And I know that we have some people here who are connected with the Confucius Institute. And it seems to me that what he's saying is very close to a long-held Chinese ideal, namely that in education there should be no distinctions based on class or type, however you want to define it. But Hutchins also said that one purpose of education is to draw out the elements of our common human nature. And this has to do with a longer statement that he made, that it's the task of every generation to reassess the tradition in which it lives, discover what it cannot use and discard it, and to bring into context with the distant past the most recent contributions. Again, seems to ring true if we look back at the Analects. a person who can bring a warmth to the old, can sort of let it simmer, I suppose, is the person who can understand the new and is qualified to be a teacher. And it seems to me that these kinds of values that Hutchins talks about and Confucius talks about a good deal before Hutchins, the kinds of things that can help us understand Kuo Ping Wen's importance. At Wooster College, he was involved in editing the student newspaper. He was involved in many literary societies, some religious societies. He was also a very skilled orator. When he arrived at the college, at the preparatory school, the prep school, he was already probably 24, 25 years old. So when he enrolled at the college itself in 1908, he was perhaps 26 years old. So he was a mature, young man. And I want to say something about what happened to him at the college. Because he came to Wooster College having experience in China with the Shanghai Haiguan, the customs house, but he also had the ambition to become a lawyer, to go into law. This is why he came to the college. Not that the college has a law school, but he would eventually go into law. And somewhere, somehow, at some point in his college education, he changed course. I don't know, can we call it an epiphany? I'm not sure. Some sort of revelation. And this happens to many students as they pursue their college careers. They shift gears, they see something they want to pursue, and they do so with a passion, and that's exactly what he did. He decided he wanted to go into education. And so you people connected with Teachers College, I'm sure, say, well, gee, this is a great thing. You know, here's a fellow thinking of becoming a legal eagle, perhaps in Shanghai, went back and became a very significant educator. And I'll finish my part of this by saying that his liberal arts background seems to have brought about that kind of shift in his thinking, this wide-ranging education. And his stress about balancing specialized education with well-rounded education, humanistic education with scientific education, the fact that faculty had to be supported as well as facilities, and most important, which I think is something that Carolyn brought up, that there has to be a balance between national interests and international understanding. And so this quite remarkable person got his start at Wooster. I don't want to say we shaped him, but I think he kind of had a little bit of a liftoff at the college. I'll turn things over to my friend Ryan, I think, here, and then we'll move down the line.
Sure.
Thank you.
David, that was great. Thanks. So just by the order that we're sitting sequentially here, I'll be talking about, I've been tasked today to talk about Kuo as a statesman. So we're kind of time traveling a bit, but you'll get it. You're a smart crowd. When we first were tasked with putting this book together, G and I, at first we're just two sort of young scholars at the very beginning of our PhD studies. I appreciate Jim granting us the title of doctor already. Hopefully they just give our degrees right now then. Just kidding. But we were just really hoping that we could maybe get a chapter in to the book. We didn't know that we'd be tasked with being able to take control of this whole volume. And as sort of things started rolling along and some of the other academics, professors, and whatnot sort of said, well, I'm too busy. It was obvious that the two young scholars would take that role. And I appreciate Carolyn really sort of letting us take that and entrusting us that we'd come out with something special, and hopefully it is special. And it's really great to be a part of something with other sort of classically trained historians. I think G and I especially, we come from a background of social science, but with an importance with history. And looking into this, I think it's been an amazing experience to sort of jump into this amazing life. So I thank you guys for just letting me be a part of it. And when I was going back to look at the book, I mean, it's been several years now since we first started writing this or putting it together. And if you know publishing, I mean, it takes just, you know, years to get everything together. But it's amazing looking at the book and finding just these titans of history contained within the book that cross paths with Guo. So we have the great diplomat Wellington Koo. We have the amazing Chinese intellectual Liang Qichao, Sun Meiling, Chiang Kai-shek, John D. Rockefeller makes an appearance in the book, and FDR, the great president. And you just find these on page to page, chapter to chapter. And so it's amazing to see, look at these sort of titans from maybe somebody that a lot of people don't actually know. So that's been a lot of fun to go back and rethink from that perspective. But what I'm going to get into is the idea of Kuo as a statesman. And what is a statesman? Sort of, it's an advocate, it's a diplomat, it's somebody who's potentially a politician, a lobbyist, and Kuo did a lot of these things. G's going to talk about his education, teacher's college, and some of the education reform stuff. And then also we have Yanqiu's going to talk a little bit about the China Institute as well. But for me, what I really dug into was when he comes back in 1925 from China after a tumultuous time there. He was the head of the Southeast University, basically gets run out by sort of another faction that took over during this period. Comes back to the United States, and what does he do? Well, he goes and he's a lecturer at the University of Chicago Harris Foundation. And he's going around the country giving these speeches across the United States, maybe not unlike something that you might see right now. And he's, what is he doing? He's advocating for U.S.-Chinese relations. He's advocating that the United States should be treating China better. He specifically talks about, look what happened during World War I. China was on your side. China sent over hundreds of thousands, actually, laborers to France to help with just basic things like getting water, digging ditches, 500,000 apparently, or up to 500,000 in Russia before that sort of fell. And then what happens at the end of World War I? C.C. Wong and Wellington Koo say, we want Shandong back. Don't give it to Japan. Germany had it before, right? And what happens? Well, they give it to Japan. And so in these speeches that he's giving, he's talking about these things. And he's not talking simply to politicians in these lectures. He's talking to the everyday man. He's saying, what can you do? What can you do? Well, you're the everyday person. Go talk to the people who are in charge. Not me, you. You have to tell them to make these changes. And he's trying to advocate, he plays up this idea that what's going on in China is akin to what happened in the United States 200 years before in the American Revolution. That these young people who led a revolution in China, he calls them, they're not reds. They're not reds. They're reds because you're treating them not as whites, as the Allies, right? Red, white. He said, they're not even pink, okay? It's just the criticism that you're giving them. And he says that there's a kinship between the United States, because the United States isn't like the European powers that have carved up China. Now, whether that's, you know, actually true or not, that's, you know, but he's playing the idea of lobbying here, right? And so within these lectures, traveling around, it was great. You're going back in the archives, looking at New York Times articles that talk about Kuo, different college magazines where he's giving these different lectures. And reading his words are comparative to the things that are going on today. It's very impressive. he talks even about the idea of American exceptionalism, before American exceptionalism, that term has really been coined. And the idea that, again, America has a special place in the world to do these kinds of things. It's the only power that can sort of maybe help China come to be where China should be, as Carolyn mentioned in her opening lecture. Later on, after this is 1925, so he does this right before the founding of the China Institute, which Yanqiu will get here in a bit. But he doesn't end when he goes to the China Institute, and he doesn't end his life as a statesman or as an advocate of policy. As mentioned, he goes to do maybe even greater things with the UN and some of the early organizations during World War II and even after World War II. So, for instance, he was traveling. Let me jump back. He was traveling around Europe a little bit under the guise of the Chinese government, trying to get money, trying to raise awareness for what's going on in the 30s in China, which, as we know, it's a tough situation for the Republican government at the time. 1936, he comes to D.C., sort of rubbing shoulders with the important people in the United States at the time, including FDR. Apparently, in a meeting with FDR, he sort of plays up FDR's love of Chinese food, which apparently FDR had after some relatives had some business connections in China. But during the war, he works specifically with Herbert Lehman to create what we call the, before the UN was even started, the UN Relief and Rehab Administration, okay? And this is for the United Nations, but even before actually it's officially formed, interestingly enough. And this organization was supposed to give money to these places around the world that were destroyed by the war. So specifically China, I think, got the most funding from this organization, then Ukraine, Poland are sort of the top three money receivers from this organization. That organization only lasts a couple years. It's more for sort of just getting things up, getting relief. I think G and I went through some of the correspondence with Herbert Lehman and Kuo, which was a little dry, as you could think, just sort of passing this correspondence back and forth. But nonetheless, very important things came out of this. Also during the UN, the Chinese, also during his connection to the UN, the Chinese delegation during an early meeting helped to start the Food and Agriculture Organization, which is still a UN department today. Early on, Kuo is already understanding that food security is dearly important to people around the world. And that organization, again, I go to the website and you can't even find Kuo's name anywhere on there, right? Perhaps also maybe more important than this food organization is the Bretton Woods Conference, okay? Kuo was one of the Chinese delegates at this conference. 730 total delegates from all the allied nations go to New Hampshire, go to Bretton Woods, and basically establish what is gonna be the economic future of the world, right? They establish the IMF, they establish the World Bank. Whatever criticisms they are, the idea was to make sure that we can keep the world economically integrated. The idea of development comes out of this. It's lays the foundation, I think, for the modern world. And Kuo is there with the Chinese delegation, which I went and looked at. The Chinese delegation had one of the largest delegations of all of the countries that were there. The United States, I believe, had the most. And through this system, through this early work, these lasting legacies come out of this idea of being a statesman. One of them that we don't talk about too much is the United Nations University. Before he left, he wrote up sort of this, apparently wrote up this plan that what became the United Nations University. He didn't have a whole lot with sort of the implementation, but writes up this kind of organization. Eventually retiring to a more quiet life in D.C. towards the end of his life, still fighting for his advocacy for what he believes in. Later, he goes on to write about the Chinese American and that lifestyle and how terribly they're being treated in the United States. And one of the things he writes about is, still in 1961, there's a quota on Chinese immigration to the United States at like 106, something like that, in 1961 still. We're not talking about the Chinese Exclusion Act, which he wrote about early on in which David sort of mentioned some of the writings at Wooster. And he's saying, look at your youngest state. Look at Hawaii. You can see that the Chinese in this state have been allowed to economically and politically thrive. And they even elected the first Chinese American senator, Hiram Fong. And Kuo's talking about this, so you have to use this example. You can't let these past sort of racist ways of viewing China affect the Chinese living in the United States. And so you can see that early connection to that with the writings in Wooster when he's talking about Rong Hong, who was the first, I think, Chinese to have a BA from the United States at Yale, and his struggles in the United States, who I believe died poor and alone, and was very difficult for him because of the Chinese Exclusion Act. Kuo wrote about him when he was in college. And some of the last writings of his life, he's also talking about Chinese Americans. And so I think that when today we talk about Kuo and we're thinking about his legacy, it's the 300,000 students who are Chinese who are coming over here today. 300,000 in the United States, that was the last number of Chinese students studying in American universities, when there's only about 1,200 American students who are doing study abroad, usually short-term sessions in China. And actually, it's lessening in the past couple of years. So hopefully, we can take this legacy and say, hey, there's 300,000 Chinese here. Let's make it where we get this number up going to China. I think that would be something that Kuo would really hope we can sort of turn those around. So I'll turn it over to G, and he'll jump back to the early time at Columbia and education. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Thank you, Ryan, for sharing very important stages of Kuo's life. I also wanted to start off by showing my appreciation for the Starr Library for hosting us. I wanted to sort of give you a very brief summary of how Kuo Ping Wen went on to achieve the important things that he did, and how he sort of built that foundation during his time at Teachers College. So Kuo Ping Wen came to Teachers College in 1911, to study education. And Teachers College then was the first and the largest teaching institution specific for teachers. And Teachers College had the first sort of international focus on the studies of the education topic. Specifically, in the field of comparative international education, the first course was given at Teachers College in 1899. So this sort of lays the foundation and the background of how important it was for Kuo Ping Wen to come from Wooster to this institution in New York to study education with an international perspective. And I think his time during his studies really shaped his future career, including his achievements in education, in diplomacy, and other reforms. So specifically, let's talk about what really shaped his life as a scholar. The first and most important influence that Kuo received was from his advisors. He had three important advisors during his time at Teachers College. One of whom is George D. Strayer, who is a research scholar specifically in education administration. He was a very prominent scholar who was writing a lot of books and articles about how schools and reforms should be run. And so this was the first formal sort of scholarship interaction that Kuo received during his early years at Teachers College. Then Kuo also had another advisor who was also working with him on his dissertation, who was Professor Farrington. Professor Farrington approached the topic with a more sort of philosophical perspective. And then last but not least, and most importantly, was Paul Monroe, who really introduced Kuo Ping Wen to the idea of, you know, looking at education from a development and international perspective. As we all know, Paul Monroe sort of lays the groundwork for a lot of US-China education exchanges. And later on, Yanqiu will talk about how Kuo and Paul Monroe moves on to a sort of come up with the idea for founding the China Institute. But my point here is it's really Kuo's academic training at Teachers College that built up his interest and his skills for him to really look into the problems and find solutions that he later proposed, the four balances that would solve the problems in Chinese education at the time. So one of these solutions that he proposed was to start the first co-education higher learning institutions, which at the time, if you revisit the archives at the time, actually Columbia was in co-ed. So if you situate Kuo in his time and you think about these things that he observed when he's traveling on campus, going from classes to classes, it really shaped a lot of his ideas in his later stage when he advocates for such co-educational reform. Another point I wanted to make was his extracurricular, his non-academic activities while he was at Teachers College. So when we looked up Kuo Ping Wen's files at Teachers College, it was very sort of a humanizing moment for us when we think about where this is the building that he used to live. So this was a moment where we put this person, a historical figure who was very famous and who had a lot of achievement, that he was a student while he was here. He lived on 121st in Amsterdam. And that was the moment when we felt that we need to look into what he did outside of his classes. And what was important to note that he, to put this, the reason why it's important to look at what he did outside of classes was to think about when he went back to Nanking to found Southeast University, he hired a full department of Teachers College graduates to teach education in the newly founded institution. And how was he able to do that? How was he able to hire an entire department of only TC graduates? That was impressive. And the reason behind was he was so active on campus. He was, name any event or activity that he wasn't sort of having an important role in. And he was always, you know, involved in all these campus speeches. He was involved in the campus newspaper. He was part of the Chinese student, it was part of the Chinese Student Alliance at the time. So he had all these important connections and brotherhood that he built while he was studying here during his time that he was not in class. So that was an important note. And lastly, I wanted to shed some light in terms of what really built his international outlook into looking at education. I think if you think about the time that he was situated in, he was in uptown New York in a society that was segregated, and he really went on to think about what is the role of education in a society that should promote sort of the different kinds of balances. And how do we achieve better equality in terms of genders? How do we achieve better equality of sort of disciplinary focuses? And how do we achieve sort of a nationalism and an internationalism outlook? How do we achieve these different perspectives? So for him, it was really the experience in New York where he was exposed to these kind of differences and to these different perspectives that really brought him to think about and revisit these topics that later sprouted his interest in promoting national education with international outlook. So that is my sort of take on, you know, how and what shaped Kuo's career when he was at Teachers College.
Hello. First of all, I also want to reiterate my gratefulness to Carolyn and especially to Chen Laoshi, Professor Jim Chen, who has already very generously conferred me the doctoral degree. And I really feel very honored, but on the other hand, very uneasy sitting here right now. Because, first of all, as a non-Columbia student, I am talking about a Columbia alumni. And the second thing is, worse still, as a graduate student of Northwestern University, I am commenting on an ex-president of the National Southeast University in China. So, I am going to stick to what I write for the chapter, and it's also comforting to know that there are some Peking University alumni sitting in the audience. So, I think what I want to achieve in my chapter is basically twofold. The first thing I want to do is to find out who the real founder is for the China Institute. And second of all, I want to understand Guo's involvement in that institute and in terms of some larger historical trend. So first of all, the founders, the real founders of the China Institute, if people are gearing up for tonight's vice presidential debate, here is a little bit warm up fact checking. And the tricky thing for historians is we don't really have a black and white piece of paper saying that this is what you want to know, right? You need to piece together different kinds of primary and secondary sources and also try to understand the historical context before you can have a tentative conclusion. So in terms of the founders of the China Institute, there are different sayings, and a very popular one is, again, no offense to the big fans of John Dewey and Hu Shi out there in the audience, they are the founders. And according to my little bit of fact-checking, I don't think they are very probable founders, because when the China Institute was founded in 1926, John Dewey had already left the board of the foundation, which decided to establish the China Institute. So that's one thing. Another thing about Hu Shi, if you look at his diary in 1926, there was no entry on the China Institute. He was busy with the British delegation for the Boxer Indemnity. So based on these two reasons, and also based on the track record of Kuo Ping Wen and Paul Monroe as institution builders, so taking into consideration that kind of context, I think, and I stand to be corrected if there are more documents coming my way, Kuo Ping Wen and Paul Monroe are the most probable founders of the China Institute in 1926. And actually, for this, I do have a piece of evidence, but that's a little bit late, coming from Kuo Ping Wen's 1943 recollection when he gave a luncheon talk at the China Institute in May of that year, 1943. So he said in 1926, when he was on a lecture tour in the United States. He drafted a document for the future China Institute. And since he was in the United States, Paul Monroe, yes, was the person who took the document with him to China and delivered this document to the board of the foundation, which decided to establish the China Institute. So that's how I think why Kuo Ping Wen and Paul Monroe are the most important, the most probable founders of this China Institute. But again, why do we need to care about this China Institute and what it does and Guo's involvement in that institute? I think we have people coming from the Confucius Institute, and actually the China Institute founded in 1926 was to promote Chinese culture in the United States, and I don't think I need to remind you the potential connection between the China Institute and the Confucius Institute, and I'm happy to address more of that in the Q&A, and if you will be more patient, wait for my dissertation. And. So, first of all, I want to share with you a piece of a quote from someone whose identity I will not reveal for now, just to, you know, raise your curiosity. So, this person basically said, "We need to teach foreign students to appreciate Chinese learning, which would over time make them agreeable to our manners and understand our subtleties and beneficial to us." This probably sounds familiar, right? This could easily come from the China Institute or even the Confucius Institute, right? People wanting to influence foreign opinions of Chinese culture. But actually, the person who made this comment was the son of Zheng Guofan, and his name is Zheng Jize, when he was the Chinese minister to a bunch of Western European countries in the 1880s. So I just want to share this piece, this quote with you to show that actually, sentimentally, Chinese, cosmopolitan Chinese, have always wanted, at least starting from the late 19th century, they really wanted to teach foreigners about Chinese culture. Right? But that's at a sentimental level. And the real significance of the China Institute, founded in 1926 by Kuo Ping Wen and Paul Monroe, I think, is for the first time, cosmopolitan Chinese intellectuals like Kuo Ping Wen, they tried to build, put their sentimental thinking on the need of teaching foreigners Chinese culture at an infrastructural level. So they decided to establish this institute, China Institute, trying to use this institutional platform to promote Chinese culture. And I think this is really a very different phase of, if you will, Chinese cultural diplomacy. And that also represented the very conscientious efforts of Chinese intellectuals like Kuo Ping Wen. They tried to upend the foreign dominance in narrating Chinese culture to foreigners, because up till that point, how did most of foreigners understand China? It's usually through missionaries, right? It's usually through foreign diplomats and foreign merchants. And again, no offense to those wonderful missionaries who have actually done a lot of wonderful work in China, but the Chinese intellectuals still felt that it is the Chinese responsibility to really tell the Chinese perspective on their own culture, right? And I think you have heard from all the other great panelists about what Kuo Ping Wen did at different stages of his career, and I don't think coming from the history department, if you ask a historian of modern Chinese intellectual history, Kuo Ping Wen would be remembered as a great Chinese intellectual per se. But I think he really represents an action-oriented, right, cosmopolitan Chinese intellectual who is able to combine book learning into practice. And we have a lot of great intellectuals, but again, no offense to the professors, they are not necessarily the great institution builders, but thanks to people like Kuo Ping Wen and Paul Monroe, we have the China Institute, which still exists today, and we also have the Confucius Institute. Right? So that's what I would say, and I'm happy to address more questions in the Q&A. Thank you.
I'd like to thank all the speakers. I was very interested in what Yanqiu had to say, because this idea of being of people of ideas and people of action, there of course is a long-standing tradition in Chinese culture of the unity of knowledge and action. One of the great thinkers of the Ming Dynasty, of course, is famous for this. And modern Chinese scholars have wrestled with this issue for some time. Is it more important to act? Is it more important to study and to know? How do you relate these two things? There's one issue that I would like to see how our panel reacts to. When the College of Worcester was in its early days in the 1870s, the first president said the following, that there should not be discrimination in admissions based on race, color, or sex. The basic criteria, mental and moral achievement. Sounds like an early version of Martin Luther King, doesn't it? I believe that this idea at the college had an impact on Kuo, because you know he transformed the Nanjing Higher Normal School, is it Nanjing Gaodong Shifan Xueqiao, huh, into Southeastern University, which of course was a very important co-educational institution. And so I wonder how our panelists react to this idea of co-education from what you've studied with respect to Kuo Ping Wen. Education of women as part of the process of modernizing China.
So as we talked about, if you go back, and in the book we have the concluding chapter from his dissertation, and in that, right up there with the idea that you should have a balance between global and local, right up there with decentralization and centralization, a balance between that, he has next to that within those sections the idea that we should have gender sort of, I don't know about parity, but in the same institutions. Mm-hmm. And so you can see it wasn't just a random idea that he went to Nanjing and said, oh, wait a second, maybe we should have women in this institution as well. It was something that was as important as the idea of what we learn from the West should also be localized to what we know and have about China as well. And same with the ideas of the other balances. Whether he got that from Wooster or that grew from Wooster and then really crystallized into how you can put that into action at Teachers College with curriculum and things like that that he was studying there, I think you could certainly say that that was sort of the stair step.
One of his fellow students at the college, a contemporary of Kuo, named Liao Fengxian, who is the sister-in-law of C.T. Wang Zhengting, was very steadfast in her support of women's education. And so you have a group of people, the general tone of the college. Carolyn, could you?
I'll get a chair.
So there seems to be a nucleus of people who are interested in a very broad scope for education, and some of these ideas then expanded out into the establishment of institutions in China. Well, I've been told that perhaps we should open up the panel and our very patient audience to some questions for our panelists. Just don't ask me any questions. Now, since Carolyn is here, I think she would like to say something too.
I would just like to add one more thing about Kuo Ping Wen's, what influenced him about thinking about co-ed education. I think Worcester really how he thought, but the idea actually came from when he was at Lowry Prep School. And you know, it was a missionary school and it was co-ed. And so that's where he actually began to think that, oh, you know, boys and girls can go to school together. And I think what he experienced was a very good experience. And when he came to Worcester, that just only really reaffirmed everything.
Yes, I think the Farnhams, Mr. and Mrs. Farnham, were instrumental in turning that academy into a co-educational school. Well, questions? Comments? Yes.
I just want to say thank you for the great introduction by Ryan and all the panelists. I have a question. When you look through Kuo Ping Wen's life, he actually has spent a lot of time in China, you know, putting his educational beliefs in actions, founding a lot of universities and institutes. But in 1949, he actually chose to stay in the United States. You know, in your book, you know, what's your idea of like his decision, or what's his intention of staying in the United States instead of, you know, spending his time in China, you know, doing more things for the students in China?
So I can take a little bit of that, and if you guys want to think of your answer as well, but he was already working very close within the Republican government with all of the figures who are who you already know in Chiang Kai-shek, Tsung Mei-ling, we see T. Wong Wellington, who we've already brought up. The idea that you could just then say, okay, I'm going to go and work in the communist government, whatever that might look like. We don't know what in 49, 48, we didn't know what that might look like 50 years later. All they knew is that I'm working for this, I'm on this faction. I don't think there was really any realistic way to then jump over, at least maybe from Kuo's perspective. But I don't think we have sort of writing, or unless there was sort of a family discussion about this.
Well, maybe I can just shed a little light. And Kuo Ping Wen really did not belong to any party per se. He was truly an individual, and all he wanted to do was work for the country. And as he was already outside of China when 1949 came, when we had a change of government, as at that time he became the director of the United Nations Rehabilitation Relief Fund, as Ryan mentioned before, and he was involved also with the Food Administration, FAO, and I think he felt that he could better serve China. At that time in 1949, we really weren't, no one was really sure where the situation was going. We knew there was a change of government, and so he chose to remain outside. He felt that he could serve China much better where he was. And unfortunately, as time went on, no one could really return.
I think also that many of the institutions under the People's Republic were transformed quite a bit after 1949. I know this is the case with Yanjing University, for example. And I think there was a decidedly anti-missionary, anti-Western tone to politics at that time. And so people who were connected with colleges that came out of the missionary tradition, I think, didn't quite fit in with the political climate. So I think it was somewhat of a sensitive issue as to how you could blend in now with the new aims of the People's Republic, of the new government. It was not an easy thing to shift gears toward a new ideology like that.
I just wanted to add that, of course, 1949 must be a tough choice for a lot of people right in the center of that situation. I remember my grandmother, my paternal grandmother, her first husband was a nationalist officer, and they had the opportunity to go to Taiwan in 49, but just two of them, but they already had three kids in 49. So my grandmother decided to stay behind with the kids. Only her husband went. So that's that. But I'm sure for other intellectuals, what I want to say is, no matter what side they chose, especially for those, you know, remaining in mainland China, or, you know, those who went to Taiwan, it does not necessarily mean that they endorsed the government wholeheartedly. So, for example, Hu Shi, who decided to, you know, put his lot with the nationalist government, it doesn't mean that he endorsed every policy of Chiang Kai-shek, right? So he remained a very severe critic of the nationalist government in the 1950s, but of course he was very tactical. He did not want his critic to be too severe so that, you know, Chiang Kai-shek would, you know, dismiss him altogether. But on the other hand, for those people who remain in Beijing, my sense is not every one of them would, you know, imagine things to be changing so dramatically in the early 50s, especially after the Korean War. Actually, in the historiography of the People's Republic of China, there is the term of the so-called honeymoon period, right, between the intellectuals and the government, and in the first few years, but after the Korean War, since People's Republic of China and the United States were, you know, at war in the Korean Peninsula. So the things must be very, very different for those scholars who have always been identifying with, you know, cosmopolitanism and liberal education. And suddenly that became, you know, American values, that became, you know, capitalistic values.
Many of these intellectuals had a very hard time, very sad story. People like Feng Yolan, for example, treated very badly. And so I think in terms of the view of intellectuals, the intellectual class, it was not exactly a harmonious arrangement.
And I just have one last point to add. I would like to second Carolyn's point that Kuo was really a nonpartisan diplomat, politician. The reason why I say this is, if you ask the question why Kuo didn't return to China in 49, was in fact making an assumption that he had the choice. So if you think about the embargo of goods and the reduced personnel mobility after 49, from the US going to China, maybe perhaps that wasn't a choice at all. But the more important question is, why didn't he go leave the US to go to Taiwan? And that was maybe a statement of why and what sort of political stance that he took, that he wasn't a partisan politician, but instead a nonpartisan.
He'd had some trouble at Southeastern University, of course, in the 1920s, in the mid-1920s, trying to deal with political factions. And so perhaps he had had his fill of politics seeping into educational policy, which is sometimes not the best thing, politicizing education. Some questions? Yes.
I think to keep everything in proper perspective and effective of what's going on, that intellectuals, people who were opera singers, industrialists, anyone who went back, got into very serious trouble. I don't think anyone escaped, and Kuo Ping Wen was very lucky he didn't go. If he had gone, he probably would have been what, purged, like anybody else. I think we forgot how bad things were.
I think probably you talked, Yanqiu, about a honeymoon period. Probably 1956 seems to be the key date with the Hundred Flowers Movement and the purge of intellectuals. Yeah, way before, but that's the...
So I have a question myself for David, actually.
Uh-oh.
Because David was very generous and said he wanted to reserve time for us, but David's chapter and David's research really helped us provide the impetus to just create this full breadth of volume. So we really, really appreciate it. But can you just talk about the life of a Chinese student in the United States during that time? Was he representative of what that was like, or was he sort of extraordinary because, you know, maybe he wasn't, because he was 24 when he when he first came here? Can you talk about that?
Well, you know, there were three students around the same time, all of whom went to Wooster, two of whom graduated from Wooster, and all of whom went to Columbia, actually, right after Wooster. Of course, there's Guo, and then there's a fellow by the name of Ying Shangde. Also went to Columbia and went back to China to found the biology department at Nankai Dashui. He was a very important figure then in terms of scientific education in China, and he got his start really at Columbia, I think. But he was involved in many of the oratorical contests that were in place around that time at Worcester, and Kuo Ping Wen had won many of these contests, and so did Ying. And the other one is this lady, this woman, Liao Fengxian, who went back to China and was one of the prime movers in founding Lingnan University, very much interested in women's education. And so all three of these, actually they were at Worcester at the same time. Liao Fengxian transferred and went to Wellesley and was a year ahead of Sung Meiling at Wellesley. Yes. I don't know. Does that
help
to answer it?
That was great.
Except I don't know what it was really like for a Chinese in Worcester in, let's say, 1910. You know, I mean, it's really hard, you know, even to say, you know, what things are like today. Except I think there was an unusual atmosphere of open-mindedness. I mean, the Chinese students would do small performances. I don't know what the substance of it was, but apparently Guo gave a presentation that was called A Chinese Joke. Kai Wanxiao. I don't know exactly what it was. It wasn't documented. And he and Miss Liao were involved in a musical performance, too, of Chinese songs. She even gave a talk at the local, this is not even the college, this is the local YWCA about women's education in China. And she attempted to make a case for the liberation of women in China, quite different from what her mother and grandmother had experienced. So there was an interest in the community in these Chinese students. There seems to be an acceptance of them at the college. I can't say that racism was obliterated in some way at that time, and it continues today, of course, you know, to a lesser extent. But Guo, I think, was quite courageous when he won an oratorical contest with a speech called China's Remonstrance, and it was about the immigration issue. And this was in 1909. And so it was right around the time of the boycott of 1905 to protest the exclusion acts, which had really tightened up around 1905. And people feared that if Chinese made too much of a noise about it, you know, with the boycott, it would hurt the Boxer indemnity, the Boxer indemnification of Chinese students coming to China. So to stand up for something like that is a bit, it's a bit courageous, I think. Anyway, I mean, aside from the financial interests, you know, in terms of the indemnity. So, I mean, he wasn't somebody who just backed off, you know. I mean, he said what he thought and stood behind it.
if you don't mind another history nerd giving you another book to read. I think there is a professor at University of Massachusetts, Boston, and she published a book in 2001, which is titled Seeking Modernity in China's Name. It's about the history of early Chinese students studying in the United States. And I want to add a little bit about why the China Institute, the organization I study in my dissertation, was actually founded in the United States. If you still remember the quote I shared with you a moment ago, in the late 19th century, when Chinese intellectuals were talking about the need to teach foreigners about Chinese culture, they were not talking about a specific, you know, foreign country per se. They were just talking about foreigners, and you know, it could be Western Europeans, it could be Americans, right, or Japanese, or Russians too. But in the 1920s, the China Institute was founded here, I think, exactly because a lot of Chinese students studied here, and in the early 20th century, when those Chinese students were here, they were not just learning from the books, but they were also learning from the student activities and the so-called, you know, what Tocqueville has already called the associational life of, you know, American society. They have really taken that into their heart. And you can see from the career of Kuo Ping Wen, right? He joined all kinds of student organizations, and you can also see that in Hu Shi and in many other Chinese intellectuals who later, you know, involved in the China Institute. So I think there is a reason why the China Institute was founded here in the United States in the 1920s, right? So.
Do we have another question or two? I was looking for a photograph that's in the book, and it's a photograph that of one of the literary societies at Worcester College, and it features Kuo Ping Wen, who was a member, and there's a very tall, blonde fellow standing next to him in the photograph, and he has his arm around Kuo, and just a nice touch, you know. He was very much a part of these societies, and I think they offered enough opportunity to contribute something. In his case, very often talking about Chinese culture, he could contribute enough that it held people's interests and it made him a part of the community. Well, if there are no more questions, we'll thank Jim very much. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't see your hand. Please, please, yes.
But why, like, so, like, 41, 100 years old, they can do, they are learning here, and they can do tremendous things for China. And what about our students now? What can we take out from here and implement in the new century? What do we can take out from another generation? And because we do want to do something for China, but we are less capable. We just admire him. Wow. How can you do that?
It's always difficult to follow a pioneer, isn't it?
Well, I suppose one thing today, what's a little different than the students, and especially when Kuo Ping Wen came to study, is the motives are quite different. People have many reasons for coming abroad to study now. Some people want a holiday. Some people want to, you know, they just want a degree from a foreign name brand. And there are those who want to pursue real knowledge, and there are those who want to pursue knowledge and with a motive to go home to help, to return home and build a country. And that was really the one goal that all the students who went abroad from China in the Republican era had. There was really no other reason. You know, it was to learn about, in order to be able to successfully deal with foreign countries, you had to understand them. And so by going abroad, learning how they think, how the people think, and how to interact with them was one thing. And then also by learning from them, and then you could return home and contribute. So I think for the students today who want to, you know, feel, what can I do or why am I here, you have to think, one has to think about, what is your end goal? You know, do you want to help your country? Do you want to contribute? Or do you want to just pursue whatever interests yourself?
Yeah, no, maybe not thinking of the sort of how can we aspire to be these great people in society, but just taking some small things from Kuo and his story. When he was at Wooster, he was in every single club. He was in the debate club. He was in the Peace Society, Athena Society, Chinese. He's in all these different clubs. He's writing for the newspaper. When he comes to Teachers College, we have one of his report cards. And we saw that his grades weren't that great, actually, comparatively to some of the other students. But that didn't matter, right? That didn't matter. And so I think maybe when we come to a university, this isn't just a Chinese student problem, but it could be for a lot of students, I think, today. All we think about is, I got to get this grade. That's all that matters. And just if you could take one lesson, maybe that isn't all that matters. You need to do all of these other things to really allow you to fly once you get out, or to have these connections, or to do these interesting things.
And one thing I just want to add is, really, Kuo Ping Wen, you know, by writing and researching about Kuo Ping Wen's life, the one lesson I learned is to be a little unrealistic at 25. I think a lot of the things that Kuo Ping Wen did were unusual or out of the ordinary. If you look back at, you know, his age in 25, when he was graduating from Wooster, when he's coming to Teachers College. So in that sense, you know, he really achieved a lot of the unrealistic, the abnormal that you would normally judge when you were at 25. You know, what would be the normal? The normal would be to find a good paying job, you know, stay in a first world country and not go back to war. Go back to a country that is, you know, being torn apart by war and try to build universities. I think that is the realistic choice. But instead, that is what Kuo taught us, to be a little unrealistic at age 25, pursue the things that you think are important and make it happen. Even if you don't, you'll be always remembered.
I think it raises another issue, doesn't it, in terms of the role of the liberal arts education in today's society, where the job situation is so difficult. People getting out of college find it very hard, you know, to apply their talents. One thing that impressed me, which I know I've been harping on, is the fact that Kuo Ping Wen shifted gears when he was in college. Maybe it's necessary in today's world, and a lesson we can learn is, don't be afraid to shift gears, whether it's in your major, whether it's going to college, or doing something completely different from what you thought you were going to do. So I'll follow up on G's point that, you know, you have to be creative in finding your path.
If I may second David's point, I am now, of course, doing a PhD in history, but I started college as a philosophy major, and I thought, you know, reading the books is wonderful, but those books are a little bit too abstract for me, so I want to do something a little bit more concrete with a concrete social impact. So I went into education, and I think that's probably too practical for me, so I want to find a balance. That's how I come into history, and I'm not considering myself as, you know, successful example here, but I think it tells people, you know, we these days we have the luxury a little bit, right, to explore ourselves, what we really want to do, what we are capable of, what we can do, and I think that's probably the most important thing about education, and that's not necessarily in the books.
Do we have any more questions? Yes. Oh, we have a couple. We have a couple. Yes, Vivian. You got up first.
A student from Professor Gedalecia. So I'm currently a student at Teachers College. So I think my academic path might be really similar to that of Kuo Ping Wen, though our achievement is not comparable, of course. But my question is actually towards Kuo Ping Wen's achievement at Teachers College and his involvement with the student organization, because I'm currently the president of Future China Initiative. We're actually a Teachers College-based Chinese student organization, and it's actually founded by Hu Shi, Jiang Mengling, and Tao Jingzhi during their time at TC in the year of 1913, I think. So I don't know whether during your research you have come across any evidence or any historical documents indicating whether Kuo Ping Wen played a role in the organization, or because from my perspective, I think that might be a really interesting, I guess, case to study, see whether there's any, you know, crossover, any, you know, his active involvement in that organization and how that shaped his activity at Teachers College.
Yeah. Specifically, during Kuo's time at Teachers College, he wasn't specifically personally involved in the Chinese Student Club, which was the previous sort of the origin of the Future China Initiative that you mentioned. But he was involved on the larger campus, where he was the deputy, the vice president for the Chinese Student Alliance under Wellington Koo, who was the president at the time. Wellington Koo was doing his PhD in political science at the time. So I think there are definitely a lot of crossovers, like you mentioned, Hu Shi, Jiang Mengling. They all had these common interests in education, and they founded this student organization that has a specific interest in education. And for Kuo, it was more to reach out to the broader campus and really to find out explore where his interests lie. And I think that speaks to his involvement not only in the education field, but also his later work in diplomacy, in reforms, and international work.
He was a member around 1909, 1910, of the Chinese Students Christian Association, and C.T. Wang was also in that group. And what I learned from that was that association, very important one, because you had these kinds of fraternal organizations on the Lower East Side to help immigrants from Europe, especially Jewish immigrants, assimilate into American society, but they needed help. Anyway, the Chinese Students Christian Association provided practical services to Chinese students arriving from China, going to China or Europe, looking for homes, employment, how to make purchases in need of assistance. And so this is something that could really be very important, I think, today for Chinese students coming to the United States still.
So I just want to add that this is actually what the China Institute did when it was first founded all the way through the 50s. It really was a home away from home for the Chinese students. It was career counseling, it was a place for parties, engagements, etc.
I think, again, we should remember the historical event which took place since the Opium War. What happened then was they were just one invasion after another, and China signed one concession after another. And many intellectuals at the time blamed the problem that we had due to the archaic education we had. So many people came to America, went to Europe to study, hoping to bring back new ideas to help China. And when you talk about 1909, I mean, the revolution thing it seems that succeeded was 1911. So it's really during that time when maybe intellectuals, that's what they wanted. And I think one thing that impressed me, like Wenbo, who was the president of China Institute, he told me he came here to study, and he was recruited by Thornton to go back to help the Chinese students, because he knew someone like Wango, a great intellectual, well-educated, non-corrupt, and Wango went back to China. Of course, he he did leave when the revolution, right? So I think a lot of people, probably including Kuo Ping Wen, they came here really answering her question, because China was so weak. We had, you know, I lived in the French concession in Shanghai. I mean, we knew what was going on at the time. And a lot of people came here to study or go to Europe to study, wanting to go back to help China to, well, to stop these events which were going on. That was really the big reason. Whereas a lot of people today, they wanted to come here. I'm not sure what they really wanted to go back to China, to bring back to China. Things have changed a lot.
I think we're... Well, I'd like to thank you all for coming. I would like to thank Jim for arranging this wonderful confab. And I'd like to thank Carolyn for being the mover and shaker behind the conference 2 years ago, a wonderful conference at Teachers College, and this meeting today. But I'd especially like to thank our three scholars down the line here for the tireless work they've done to produce this book. And I hope you'll enjoy reading it. It's a monumental piece of work, and they deserve all the plaudits here. And I'd like to thank Yanqiu and Liu Ji and Carolyn and Ryan and Jim. Thank you.